Good evening. This is a somber evening, but we must remember that in Jesus' day, it was a festive evening. The disciples had come to the upper room that had been prepared for the Passover feast, as we had it described for us Sunday here at First Baptist with Christ in the Passover. So they came in happily greeting one another. And it was Passover. It was a celebration that they had been delivered from their bondage by the Egyptians from Egypt. And they had been delivered by God, who alone deserved their praise and thanksgiving and honor and glory. But that night, something happened in the transition when Jesus taught them that that was the night they should be mandated, commanded to love one another as he had loved them. It was in that upper room that he knelt and took a basin of water and washed their feet, showing ultimate humility and the epitome of humility. It was in that upper room where he alone was telling them things that they did not understand, that this is my body which is broken for you, and this is my blood which is shed for you. And they were looking back and forth thinking, what is he talking about? Of course, that was, we call it Maundy Thursday, the mandate night, the commandment night, where on the next day they would see what he was talking about when he was crucified between two thieves on Calvary's Hill. But it began as a festive celebration that evening. They were having dinner together, the Seder feast. They were greeting one another, and I could imagine the joyful hellos to one another. But as they did so, it soon turned very somber because they were mystified and confused about what the Master, who had walked with them and talked with them and taught them, was even talking in terminology and words they did not understand. So tonight on this Maundy Thursday of 2021, we welcome you to First Baptist Church in Whiteville. I want to say there are those who are watching online tonight or by Facebook. We welcome you as well as those who are here in the sanctuary. I do have a couple of reminders for you. I hope you all received one of the cups with the bread on the top of it. If it's in the lobby, if you did not receive one, please have that ready for a little later in the service. And if you're viewing from home, and I know people are viewing from different locations tonight, you might want to get a cup of juice or a beverage and some bread so that you can partake of the Lord's Supper with us when we come to that moment in the service. We would encourage you to do that. Also tonight, if you picked up one of the programs, we appreciate our ushers helping you be prepared with the program. You can follow along in this. And also there's another additional gift for you tonight. It's the Way of the Cross hymn meditations prepared by our own organist, Patricia Slomansky. And also included in here is the poem that I promised you in the newsletter of Joy's writing of Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Creation of God. That insert is in this program. So please take this with you and you can have further meditation over this weekend. But I just want to remind you that as we go through this service, we will extinguish the candles. The darkness will be darker and darker. And at the end of this service, you're invited to stay as long as you want to. And then leave as God leads you to leave in silence as we remember the significance of that day so long ago. Before we have our invocation, Eddie wants to explain something about the music tonight as well.
As the service goes through, you will find a number of hymns that are already placed in your bulletin and pages on them. Some of them you will recognize. You will have heard the choir sing numerous times over the years, but maybe you haven't sung them. So all we would say is sing as you're comfortable, and if you are uncomfortable singing some of the newer ones, read the words, because the text is what we're trying to get at this night, or the words that make the music so more meaningful. So be prepared and join as you can. Thank you.
Thank you, Eddie. We also appreciate Patricia and her beautiful prelude tonight of that beautiful music. Well, let's begin as they would have begun that night in a festive celebration. Would you please stand? And if you saw disciples who had followed Jesus with you, you would probably be glad to see them at the festival the Passover festival and feast that night. So would you turn and wave to one another as if you were greeting them at the Passover meal, and you're glad you're here, because later you will learn, as the disciples did, not only of the joy of that evening, but of the sorrow of the horrific events that would be unfolding in our songs and our scriptures tonight that have been prepared. As you've greeted one another, let's greet God together in prayer, may we? Father, we do thank you for the significance of this special evening, and we pray tonight that as we listen to the music and listen to the words and let your Spirit speak to our hearts, that we would remember that Thursday long ago when Jesus met in the upper room with his disciples. He washed their feet to show humility. He gave them the mandate, the commandment, that they would love one another as he had loved them. And tonight we pray that we will be renewing our faith in you and our faith and trust in each other. So bless the elements of worship tonight. We praise you for the privilege of being together in your house on this significant evening. And Lord, as we welcome one another here in this sanctuary, we welcome those who are listening or watching online or in other forms of media. And we thank you for the privilege of sharing in many places because of the gift of the media. It's in Jesus' name we pray tonight that we would be pleasing to you. For we know, Lord, that we are blessed to be a blessing. In Jesus' name, all of God's children said, amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Please stand for our first hymn, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. This will be the last hymn that will be announced, so please follow along in your bulletin as we sing and read scriptures together. Please stand.
Our responsive reading coming from Isaiah. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of dry ground. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men harbor iniquities, upon him was the chastisement that made us whole, and with his stripes we are healed. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was brought as a lamb to the slaughter. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. On that night, Jesus shared with his disciples the bread and the cup. And that's why we, on Maundy Thursday, as well as other occasions during the church year, celebrate what we call the Lord's Supper or communion. It's in the scriptures, and we are following in obedience to what he asked us to do in remembrance of him. The scripture goes this way from Mark, the 14th chapter. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, his disciples said to him, "Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?" So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher, the master, ask, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there.' So the disciples set out and went to the city, and they found everything as Jesus had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he came with the 12, and when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said, 'Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me.' They began to be distressed and to say to him one after another, 'Surely not I.' He said to them, 'It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born.'" While they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from the cup. He said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." May God bless the reading of this, his holy word. We're told that Jesus on that night took bread and broke it. He took the cup and he blessed it. And as tonight we partake of the Lord's Supper at this time, whether you're at home or in the hospital or wherever you may be, or here in this sanctuary, we're doing this in remembrance of the one who gave his life for us. May we pray together. Father, bless this bread and bless this cup tonight as we partake as you did with your disciples in that upper room. It was a different day then. It's a different day now. But Lord, the meaning is the same, that your body was broken on the cross of Calvary. Your blood was shed on the cross of Calvary for all of us who are sinners, saved by your grace, your mercy, and your love. So tonight, bless the bread and bless the cup, as you did then, as a symbol of your broken body and shed blood for the salvation of all mankind. And we thank you for that great gift of love. In Jesus' name, the one who gave his life for the sins of the world. Amen. If you would take, please, the bread from your container. Let us eat in remembrance of him. Would you prepare the cup, please? Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me." Let us drink in remembrance of him. As long and as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we do show forth the Lord's death until he comes again. If you would look at the setting before us tonight, you see the candles representing Jesus and scriptures telling about his life, his death, and his burial. Tonight we celebrate the Lord's Supper, but we also celebrate the events that followed that evening in the upper room. He sang a hymn when he was facing Calvary's cruel cross. So may I sing in sorrow's darkest hour, and without fear, and without fear, count all my gain as naught but loss and dross, my Lord, for thee. The Lamb was slain, the Lamb was slain, from the foundation of the world, we trace his sacrifice, the glorious truth revealed. They sang a hymn. One voice was never heard in song that night. Lord, is it I that mock thee with a kiss? Forbid it, Lord. Forbid it, Lord. Lest I should lose thy song, thy joy, thy light. Lest I should lose thy song, thy joy, thy light. Lord, may I sing. Lord, may I sing. Jesus went from the upper room into the Garden of Gethsemane, and the night's event and the day following were horrific. We enter now the service of shadows. Tenebrae comes from the Latin word for darkness, and it is traditionally a service for Good Friday. But we're combining the Lord's Supper tonight with the Tenebrae service of shadows. The service is centered on the slowly dimming of the lights until the passage about the death of our Lord is read. And at that time, in the service tonight, in complete darkness, a bell will be tolled 11 times. Each toll is representing 3 years of Christ's earthly life. When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. And Jesus said to them, "You will all become deserters, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee." Peter said to Jesus, "Even though all become deserters, I will not." Jesus said to Peter, "Truly I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me 3 times. But Peter said vehemently, "Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you." And all of them said the same. Then they went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took with him Peter and James and John, and he began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them, I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake. And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He prayed, Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want. He came and found the disciples sleeping, and he said to Peter, Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake even 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found the disciples sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to Jesus. He came a third time, and he said to them, Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough. The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand. Immediately while he was speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, and with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, The one I kiss is the one man you will arrest. Arrest him and take him away under guard. So when he came, he went up to Jesus at once and said, Rabbi, and kissed him. Then they laid their hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them, Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple, teaching, and you did not arrest me, but let the scriptures be fulfilled. All of them deserted him and fled. took Jesus to the high priest, and all of the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priest and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none, for many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying, "We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple, that it is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another, not made with hands.'" But even on this point, the testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up, and before them he asked Jesus, "Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?" But he was silent and did not answer. Again the high priest asked Jesus, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?" And Jesus said, "I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with clouds in the heavens." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard this blasphemy. What is your decision?" All of them condemned Jesus as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying to him, "Prophesy." The guards also took him over and beat him. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. And when she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and she said, You also were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth." But Peter denied it, saying, "I do not know or understand what you're talking about." And he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed, and the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders, This man is one of them." But again, Peter denied it. Then after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter, "Certainly, you are one of them, for you are a Galilean." But he began to curse, and he swore an oath, "I do not know this man you are talking about." At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me 3 times. And he broke down and wept.
Have you offended the
As soon as it was morning, the chief priest had a consultation with the elders and the scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He answered him, "You say so." Then the chief priest accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again, "Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you." But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed.
Oh, wasn't that a pity and a shame? And he never said a mumbling word. Oh, wasn't that a pity and a shame? And he never said a mumbling word. Not a word. Not a word. Not a word.
Now at the festival, he used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came, and they began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them, "Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priest had handed him over. But the chief priest stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead of Jesus. Pilate spoke to them again, "Then what do you do and you wish me to do with this man you call the king of the Jews?" They shouted back, "Crucify him!" Pilate answered them, "Why? What evil has this man done?" But they shouted all the more, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed Jesus over to be crucified. Then the soldiers led Jesus into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters. And they called together the whole cohort and assembly. And they clothed him in a purple cloak. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. And they began saluting him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They struck his head with a reed. They spat upon him. And they knelt down in homage to him in mockery. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. In the same way, the chief priest, along with the scribes, were also mocking Jesus among themselves, and they were saying, "He saved others, he cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe." Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. One of the criminals who was hanging there beside Jesus, deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other thief rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus replied, "Truly, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise."
The shadow of my
When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "Listen, he is calling for Elijah." And someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to Jesus to drink, saying, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down." Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now when the centurion who stood facing Jesus on the cross saw that in this way he breathed his last, the centurion said, "Truly this man was God's own son."